As we go deeper, the force of gravity shrinks, and it does so by a factor of 2. Let's see in detail why this has to be the case. The trick is to add an imaginary sphere of half the radius. And then we can look at the force from the core part and the force from the shell. And this is where the name shell theorem comes from. The core part is again a sphere, as is the complete object. So we can compare what's going to happen as we go from the large sphere to the small sphere. Distance is multiplied by 1/2 as we go down that hole. The mass is multiplied by 1/8 as we're shrinking the original sphere to half of its radius. We're shrinking the volume to 1/8 and hence the mass to 1/8 of the original value. If we take these two together, the original force will be multiplied by 1/8, because the mass appears in the numerator, divided by 1/2 squared, because the distance squared appears in the denominator. And in total, this is a factor of 1/2. And to see what's happening with the force from the shell, let's put an imaginary sphere close to the inside of that shell. If there's a gravitational force on the surface of that sphere, it has to be rotationally symmetric, for instance, like that. Can this be? No. Where would the water be flowing? We would have to drain that water somewhere, which we don't. Can the force point to the outside? No. Where would that water come from in the first place? So the only reasonable value for the magnitude of the force is 0. And hence, in total, the force goes down to 1/2 of its original value.